Store and search Church Scribe. Once you've downloaded that app, you will choose Missionary Grove as your church, and all of our events and information will be right there available at your fingertips. Do you have a heart for our community? Here at Missionary Grove, we are looking for someone who has a passion for serving our community, for reaching the lost, and that would be great at coordinating teams to serve. If you feel like this could be you, then please reach out to our Connections Coordinator, Mrs. Maddie Pierpoint. This is just a quick reminder for all of our children's ministry volunteers. We will be holding a children's ministry meeting on February 20th, immediately following the third service in our fellowship hall. Lunch will be provided, so please mark your calendars and plan to join us. Okay, parents, coming up Saturday, February 26th from 9 a.m. until 12 p.m. noon, we will be hosting a Kids Day event right here at MGBC. This event will be for preschool ages through fifth grade. We are going to be in need of a lot of volunteers to help make this event successful. So if you would be interested in helping, then please see the sign-up sheet we have posted in the Welcome Center. For more detailed information, you can contact Mrs. Janie Hunt or Mrs. Alex Bailey. And that's all the announcements I have for you this week. So now, if you all would, please stand and join us in a great time of worship.
Jesus is in this room, here right now, making this place I stand, holy Your spirit moves and breathes all around, all good and perfect things flowing down, if all of the heavens are singing along with the saints and the elders, glorious song and the praises they sing never seem to get old, then I'll stay here forever singing, holy, holy, holy Lord, God Almighty. Forever the King enthroned in glorious splendor, holy, holy Lord. Gentle love calling me closer still, Jesus, you're guiding me to your will, if all of the heavens are singing along with the saints and the elders, glorious song and the praises they sing never seem to get old, then I'll stay here forever singing, holy, holy, holy. glory as our unsearchable throne. Before you I bow. The veil is torn and the doors fling wide. I see glory as I run inside your throne room. Before you I bow. The veil is torn and the doors fling wide. Before you, I bow. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God Almighty, over all. You are, and you'll be forever. Jesus is in this room. Making this place I stand. Holy ground, holy ground.
You know, when you go to a bank, some kind of a lending institution, and you get a loan, you have debt that you have to pay. You make those payments every month. And when you get to the end of whatever contract you've signed, they fill out your paperwork and they stamp it paid in full. That's a great feeling when you get that debt paid. Well, we all have a sin debt, and we can't pay that debt. But when Jesus died on the cross, He died for our sin debt. And He stamps in blood, paid in full. So let's praise and worship the one who paid our debt.
Watch and pray, find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Now
Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Stand in him complete. Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow.
Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised his life up from the dead.
A crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Aren't you thankful we have a God who gave everything for us? Let's worship him in this next song as it says, "Here I am, here I stand." We're giving everything to him. We're surrendering to him this morning. Myself.
myself, I give myself to you. My life is not my own, and to you I belong. I give myself to you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Here I am to worship.
Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy. You're altogether wonderful to me. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me.
We're going to go back and we're going to sing Here I Am to Worship in a second. And so often when we're leading worship, we feel the need to really just get you going. And that's not really the point of it. We're here to worship him. We can't add you on to get you there. You have to worship him in spirit and in truth. It's early, but that doesn't matter. We're not on a time restraint. We're here to worship the one that gave everything for us. We're nothing compared to what he is, and he still loves us. That's why we're here to worship. That's why we're here to lift up his name. It's not because of anything we could ever do or anything we could ever say, because we're not worthy. We're not worthy. We may have that paid in full from the bank, but it's not because of anything that we did. We don't know the weight of that sometimes, but he's still worthy.
So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, you're altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship, here away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me.
Amen. Isn't he worthy of our praise today? Amen. God, here we are, our hearts poured out to you. Lord, you know the hearts of everyone in this room, God. Some full of joy, some full of sorrow and uncertainty, but Lord, just full of you is what we need, Lord. Lord, we know these situations and circumstances will come, and all of the things around us are ever moving, Lord, but you are compared to a rock. You are called the rock, and God, we know you are strong and steady. God, you never change. The winds of this world cannot blow you around. You are fully seated upon your throne, never to be removed by anybody or anything. So today, that's why we praise you. Despite all that's going on, you are God, and there is none else. You have saved us, and forever we will give you the glory and the honor that you deserve. Bless us now as we get ready for the word that will forever change our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Amen. Amen. You can be seated. Children, you're dismissed to children's church, and the nursery is already in session.
My mind is like a battlefield, and my heart is overcome by fear. And hope seems like a ship that's lost at sea. My enemies on every side, and I'm tempted to run and hide. Your gentle whisper reaches out to me. Peace holds me when I'm broken.
Amen. John chapter 15. We'll go ahead and get started this morning in the Word and praise God for it. I titled this message, How to Remain, but I would say the title probably should be, Why Are You Remaining? As I've said many times before, motive matters. And so we're going to look at John 15, and then what I've been doing is searching the scripture and looking at the word remain, and it's multiple times in the New Testament. And then we're going to start, as the Holy Spirit leads us, taking passages that use those words, that word, and working through that. So I'm excited about this morning. Just keep on praying for Tiffany. She is not well still. She had a good day Thursday, but overdid it. I put her in the bed all day Friday, and then pretty much the same way all day yesterday, and she felt a little better this morning. So y'all just keep praying for her. Pray that she won't be so hard-headed if you're watching this, Tiffany. I won't say that third service. That's the one she watches, all right? We just got to heal. She just wants to be better. How many of you have ever been sick and you just wanted to be better? Amen? She just wants to be better, but I've told her, no, that I haven't ever had an ovary taken out or anything like that, but that it you just don't get better all of a sudden. So just keep praying for her. And I only made two kids cry last night, but that's the only two that were at my house, so I was 100%. And so we're doing good as a dad. I did do 5 loads of laundry, boys. If your wife does the laundry, you better praise God for her. Like, bring her something to drink while she's doing it, something to eat. Do something, because when you start doing it, look, I got 3 girls in my house. I don't know what goes where to anybody. Praise God, Tiffany is coherent enough for me to hold them up and go, whose is this? Whose is this? And so here's how we do laundry now. She lays in the chair, and I just say, whose is this? And she says that, and I put it in the right pile. And then, you know, so. But our kids are learning chores, too. One thing I've learned in all of this is that we do too much for our children, and they don't do enough for themselves. So now they get to do the dishes. And this is my job as a father, is to make them do them dishes. You know what I'm saying? And so at least just put them in. When I was growing up, we had a dishwasher. It was my mother. Do y'all understand what I'm saying? So when I say they're doing the dishes, they're really not doing the dishes. I mean, they're. But if your kids are too lazy to put them in the dish, they put them in the sink, you put them in the dishwasher, go get the clothes, start the clothes. I never washed my first load of laundry until I was 21 years old. 21. My mom taught me the day before I left home, son, you're going to have to know how to do laundry because you can't bring them back here. So, and she was just telling, she said that in front of my dad. She was trying to look tough. She'd have let me brought them back. I learned the night before I left home, life skills. They're doing laundry. We're cleaning stuff up. They do not like it. They throw fits. They pout. But that's okay. Maybe they'll get it out of their system before they become adults. Wouldn't that be a good thing? Yeah, John 15. Pray for us. We're going to make it through. And we're going to be better off than we were when we started through it. Because everything God does, count it all joy, my brothers, when you get into these messes, James says. Because it is working out that perfection God wants in you. So we're going to be better off than we were when we come out the backside of this. And we praise God for that. We'll title this one. We'll change the title. Why are you remaining? We've worked over John 15 the last few weeks. And we'll start in John 15:4 here. We've talked about the lost and the saved. Last week, the cut off and the cut on. And this week, we'll be in verse number 4. And then John chapter number 6. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. For a branch cannot produce fruit if it is severed from the vine. And you cannot be fruitful unless you remain in me. Father, thank you that you are good and your mercy endures forever. Lord, thank you for those songs that we just sang that reminded us of how much you've done for us, Lord, and how worthy you are and how unworthy we are. Lord, it blows my mind to think that you would even care about us, Lord, as much as you've got to do and take care of even the world spinning on its axis. Father, you come down to Camden, Tennessee, and you work in the hearts and lives of every individual at the same time. Father, you hear all of our prayers. You're in all places at all times, Lord. You know everything, and you care about everyone. So help us see that this morning. Help us see your word through the lenses of the Holy Spirit, Lord. We pray that our supernatural eyes would be open, Lord. We know that in our natural man, we can receive nothing from you in this manner. So help us see these things and understand them, God. And where it applies to our life, God, you know exactly where we are and exactly where we need what we need. You know this word. It's your word today. It will accomplish what you send it to. Have your way, Holy Spirit, that we might be more like Jesus when we leave this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Remain is the theme for the year. Remember, remain in Christ, remain in church, and remain in community. Now, we believe that if you put the emphasis on the first one primarily, then the other two will happen. You can't be in love with Jesus and not in love with his church. It is completely impossible. I love Jesus. I just don't like going to church. You lie. You just lie. It's not true. You got to love the brethren. The only way you're going to love the brethren is to be around the brethren. The only way you're going to be around them is to be in some type of community. And in today's society, that community is the church setting. It always has been since the time Christ founded the church. Remain in Christ, you will remain in church. Remain in Christ, you will remain in community. When Christ is in you, when you are running towards the things of God, when Joe over here needs some help with his light bill, you say, praise God, as Christ has helped me, I'm going to help you. If somebody's hungry, you feed them. You talk to people. You love on people. You witness. You tell people about Jesus. You meet those needs. So we are going to spend more time on the remaining Christ than we are on the other two, because we believe that the other two are just a natural outflow of that which is flowing on the inside of you. Remain means this, to stay. Now, remain is a verb. In a given place, to stay in a relationship, or to stay in expectancy, to abide, to continue, to dwell, to endure, to be present, to stand, and to tarry. Matthew Henry said it this way: to constantly keep a dependence upon Christ and communion with him, and to habitually adhere to him. Habitually means a habit. We have some bad habits, amen? But a good habit, knowing that you're in Christ, and listen to me, if you're not saved, you cannot habitually dwell in Christ. People who aren't saved are in and out, in and out, in and out, in and out. People who are saved are in. You see the difference? People who saved are habitually dwelling. They are running towards the things of God. Later on in the week, that last week, my mind with Tiffany kind of took a crash Thursday, and then Friday we have a lot of time just to kind of think and sit, and we're administering meds and all that good stuff, and the Holy Spirit was just speaking to me, and He told me that I should think of nothing more than I think of Christ and what He's done for me and what I need to be doing for Him. There should be nothing in my life that takes more of my time, effort, money, or anything than the work of Christ on the earth. Like this is the okay, you want to follow me? Leave your ships, leave your nets, and come and follow me. This is the I'm habitually doing which is within me. What I've said this a million times. What's your first thought in the morning? What when you open your eyes in the morning, is it Jesus, thank you for this day you've given me? Is it your natural progression towards the things of God? So today as we talk, we're going to recount a story in John chapter number 6. John chapter number 6, that's where we will be the majority of today, where Jesus uses the word remain. Now He's going to be talking to a bunch of people who are there for the wrong reasons. And what He's trying to get them to see is who they really are and what they really need to be doing. Remember this statement. You should think about no one more than you do about the person of Jesus Christ and what He has done for you. The center of your heart, the center of your thought processes and patterns, the center of your life should be Christ crucified, resurrected for the glory of God, the salvation of your soul. And then what now, Father, that He has done this for me, what now am I supposed to be doing for Him? Let's look at verse number 22, starting in chapter number 6. The next day the crowd had stayed on the far shore and saw that the disciples had taken the only boat. They realized that Jesus had not gone with them. They're chasing after Him. Several boats from Tiberias landed near that place where the Lord had blessed the bread and the people had eaten it. So when the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor His disciples were there, they got into the boats and went across to Capernaum to look for Him. They found Him on the other side of the lake, and they asked, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" Jesus didn't want them to know where He was at. He did this many times. He would go away or stow away. He would get to a different place. The problem, though, was that it wasn't that he didn't want the crowd around Him, but this crowd was being around Him for the wrong reasons. Number one, they only wanted what Jesus could give them. Now think about this. In a society full of consumers, not contributors, the majority of people in the church and in the world fall into this category. Jesus, what can you do for me? Jesus, what can you do for me? And I understand that we're all in it for that, but there's a difference. What can you do for my flesh versus what can you do for my spirit? Now think about this. They wanted something for, we all, I want something from, I do. Right now, I pray every day, God help my wife. God help me. God bring me closer to you. I have multiple prayers where I'm asking God to do something in my life. But when they asked, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" they weren't asking, "Hey, we want to be against you. We want to come up under the wings of the shelter of the Almighty. We want to know everything that you got to say. We know that you are the Son of God." They were remaining around Jesus for the wrong reasons. Verse number 26, "You only want to be here because I fed you, not because you understand miraculous signs." Why was He doing what He was doing? Not for them to have a good church service. He was doing it so they would comprehend He was the Son of God sent from heaven that they might enter into eternal relationship with the only one who could save their sin-sick soul. They had a debt they couldn't pay, as we heard about this morning, and He was trying to reveal to them He was the Son of God. But they were more about, "Hey, you make me feel good." Think about this for just a minute. Are you here because Jesus makes you feel good? Do you understand why He's done what He's done in your life? Do you understand why he does the miraculous? What I like about Jesus is he's always very plain. He says this, but don't be concerned, verse 27, about the perishable things like food. Now he says so concerned. There's a time where you need to go to the grocery store, amen? But your life ain't about your belly. You listening to me? We eat to live. We don't live to eat. Food gives you nourishment to do the will of God. That's why it's here. We can enjoy it. I get it. But that's not life. We think more about Friday night at the restaurant than we do Sunday morning at the altar. Where are we going to go eat? How many times you said that this week? What's for supper? Where are we going to go eat? What's for supper? What'd you eat today? I mean, it's kind of trivial, isn't it? It's funny. We laugh. We giggle. We think about it. But here's a group of people who are more concerned about, hey, he just pulled fish and loaves out of a hat than they were about who in the world is this man who could pull fish and loaves out of a basket and it keep on coming. Do you see the difference? They were more excited about more fish and bread than they were about the one who provided the fish and bread. This is the American church. We're more excited about the fish and the bread than the one who brings this into our lives. We're so consumed with the atmosphere. We're so consumed with the next miracle. He says, spend your life looking at the things that have to do with eternity. Spend your energy on the eternal life that the Son of Man can give you. For God the Father has given me his seal of approval. It's not about the basket of bread. It's not about, hey, he can't heal you. It's not about this situation or that circumstance. Those are all things, hear me, that will work out through the overflow of who Christ naturally is in a life that is seeking him. But it's not about those things. It's about him. I promise you right now, if you could physically fit, like I'm going to the feet of Jesus physically right now, if we could be transported to the throne room of God at this very moment, we would ask him for less and we would just sit in his presence more. We would ask him for less. We've spent most of our church life and Christian life looking for the miraculous and that it would come. But really, we need to learn how to remain. Verse number 28, it says, we want you to perform God's work. We just need another miracle, Jesus. We want you to perform God's work too. And we want to do it also. We want you to do something. We want to be a part of this magic show. How can we do these things that you are wanting us to do? And if you're really him, why don't you show us a sign? So not only do they not understand who he is, not only are they there just for their bellies, hear me, not only are they there because they want a little bit of this so they can make everybody look at them instead of look at him. Did you hear that? But they're also doubting who he says he really is. Well, if you're really who you say, why don't you show us a sign? God, if you're really God, then do this for me. God, if you're really God, then show me in this way. God, if you're really God, then prove yourself to me. Here's what I'm telling you, that God himself has already proved himself to you through his Son, Jesus Christ, and has no need to do anything else miraculous for the rest of history. The resurrection of his Son was fully enough, and if you can't follow him from that point, you'll never follow him from a miracle in this place today. Was that not enough? We're the same people. We're the same people. We are this people. I mean, Moses did it for his ancestors. That's what he said to him. Now, this is Jesus. This is Jesus, the Son of God. This is the man that's working miracles in there. Show us these signs. After all, our ancestors, verse 31, ate manna. And when they were in the wilderness, the scripture says Moses gave them bread to eat. And here's where Jesus really gets serious. Now, he's always serious, but I love what he does. He just turns up the heat. If y'all can't tell, that's the way I like to do it, all right? We'll start off soft and turn the heat up just a little bit until people understand what we're doing. Christ here is fixing to unload a truth on them that they have never heard. This has never been said. This is This is, thus saith the Lord, it is written. This is the Word of God. In the beginning was the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. That is Jesus here. He is coming to them saying something that they've never heard before. They want manna from heaven. They want Moses bread. Why don't you do something like our great-grandfather Moses did? And this is what he tells them. I tell you the truth, Moses didn't give you anything from heaven. The one that they put all their money in. Oh, listen to me. If you'd have lived back then, all you would have heard about is who they were kin to. You don't know who I am. I love watching videos like that. The cop pulls somebody over and they go, do you know who I am? If I was a cop, I'd be like, I don't care who you are. I mean, literally. This is that we're... If you don't understand there's nothing new under sun, society is the same way it's always been. This is what goes on here. Well, I'm of Moses. I'm of this. I'm of this. I'm of this. I'm Abraham's seed. My great-grandfather. And Lord Jesus was the... Listen, if anybody had a right to brag about who his grandfather was and the throne that he sat on, it probably was the man that was standing right before them, because he would sit on his throne of ancestor David. David, King David, would be the throne that he sat on. And Christ is standing there before them. And you're saying, what does this have to do with remain? We're going to get there. All right, just stay with me. At this moment, he looks at them and says, Moses is not the man. My Father is the one who gave this to you. At this very moment, he is declaring that God himself is his Father. These are huge truths that Jesus is laying down to us this morning. And now my Father offers you bread from heaven. And this is what he does. He's been pointing towards Moses and Abraham and prophets and all of that for centuries. And look at the former writings and the stories that are passed down. But at this very moment, for the first time ever on the earth, Jesus points at himself and says, I am the true bread of God. I am the one who comes down from heaven, and I am the one that gives life to this world. And for the first time in their entire lives, in all of their humanity, they finally say the right thing. Sir, looking at Christ, sir, I want this bread daily. At some point, and listen to me, those who remain at some point understand the truth that Christ is the bread of life. And unless they remain or continue in Christ all of their days, they never began with him at all in the first place. Ever. Now listen to me. I get that some people have a little bit of a section of their life where they do some stupid stuff. Anybody ever been there before? I get it. We've all been stupid in our lives, and some people still are. And when I say stupid, I mean like towards righteous. Smartest people in the world, but dumb towards the things of God. Now think about this. We've all had moments like that. But if you don't ever come around from that moment, you're a lost person. Because truly saved people come back around. You can't be saved and then just float off into oblivion the rest of your life and die and expect to go to heaven. You weren't ever saved. You didn't get it. I've said this a million times, burn it in your brain. Faith that fails to finish had a fatal flaw from the first. Faith that fails to finish had a fatal flaw from the first. It was they were there for the fish and bread. They came into Missionary Grove, and everything was great. It wasn't a sermon like this one. We were in the Psalms or something, or Abundant Life Sunday. That's what it was. And boy, they felt it. And look, the ground was being prepared. And there was good, those Sundays were good. There was good seed being thrown towards that ground. But the seed didn't take root. They had some emotional affair with God. Had some kind of, I'm not doubting that they didn't touch the throne in some way. I'm not doubting that they didn't have some kind of move on them by the Holy Spirit. But when we get down a little bit later in these verses, we're going to see what it looks like to really remain. Because it's just a little bit more than what's being preached in the churches around this area today. When he looked at the bread in the wilderness, the bread in the wilderness was a Christophany. It was a picture of Christ. The bread was less about feeding the children of Israel in the wilderness, and it was more about one day Christ would point back to that point and say, hey, that was me there, and this is me now. The true bread that comes from heaven is the one that gives you life. So here's the question this morning. Which crowd are you a part of? Are you the remaining crowd because I want another miracle? Or are you the remaining crowd because he is the Messiah and you've understood it? See, we're separating sheep from goats now. We can't pull up wheat and tares because they look too much alike. But sheep and goats separate themselves. Y'all don't know nothing about farming, do you? If you don't know the difference between a sheep and a goat, you don't need to be a farmer, all right? Listen to me. This is sheep and goats stuff. Who are you? Because every time he did all this miraculous, everybody was there. Woo! Man, this is good. But when it was all said and done, and they were going to the next spot, there was about 11 of them that said, we will follow you to the end of the earth. All these people were here for this, but there was only 11 that remained. So do you, listen to this question, do you really want what Jesus has to give you? Because we're trying to go to the next level. I can go get fish and bread from Country and Western if they ever open up. Okay? I don't need no fish and bread. I can fast for 40 days on water. It's humanly possible. I don't need nothing else to eat. Y'all have fed me like a king for weeks upon end now. Literally, that's not what I need. I need a different move of God. I'm thankful for the sustaining power of God in my life to provide all of those other things. But what I like in my life is this move of God that transcends all of our humanity, and we understand the heart that God has given us is being redirected by God himself. Do you really want to remain in Christ? Well, this is the difference. Do you really want to? Jesus said, this is it. They said, give us this bread. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be thirsty again. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But you, having believed in me, even though you have seen me, however, those the Father has given me will come to me, and I will never reject them. Now think about those words. A bunch of people who were just following him for no good reason, and instead of saying, hey, all of y'all can come with me, he says, the Father is the one who gives you to me, and if he gives you to me, you cannot be rejected, for I have come down from heaven to do the will of God. Now, why is he saying these words? Because the true children of God that will remain as Christ remained faithful are the ones who in their mind say the same thing that Christ did at this point. I have been sent here, or I have come here to do the will of the Father who has sent me. Are you listening this morning? Anybody can eat fish and bread. But every time Jesus got in these moments, did Jesus just get in these moments and stay in these moments? No. He did what was necessary for the Father's will to be done, and he moved on to the next spot. He moved on to the next place. He moved on to the next miracle, because it wasn't about the miracle. It was what a miracle was teaching. He was always about the Father's business. When I was studying this, God just kept showing me places where Jesus had to redirect everybody, because everybody would be getting out of the way. They'd be getting squirrely. Y'all ever got squirrely? You know what I'm talking about? They'd be doing this and this, and we want to see this. And Jesus would say, point, pay attention, point yourself in the right direction. Believe. If you don't believe, he will reject you. But if the Father sends you, he cannot reject you. Listen to me. Those are the ones who have true belief, and this is the will of God, that I will not lose even one. Aren't you thankful for that verse? I am so thankful that when I read the scripture and see myself, I see the Father giving me to the Son, and I see the Son saying, all that the Father gives me, I cannot lose them. Now, all of y'all hard. hard heads like me ought to make that your life first, all right? You ought to say, praise God that I am found in Christ, and because He found me, because He came after me, because He chose me, because He brought salvation to me. I couldn't even get to Him on my best day, much less my worst day, because my best day has always been my worst day. He chased after me. He sought me. He bought me. He shed His blood. He wrote my name in the Lamb's Book of Life. Everything for my salvation has been done by Holy God and not by Matt Greer, and because of that, He will not lose me. I've got nothing to do with it. He's got everything to do with it. Listen to me. I don't want to serve a God who is so flimsy that when I mess up, the blood that He shed for me cannot even keep me saved. People who believe you can lose your salvation believe in a God whose blood is so weak that they can be baptized in the blood of Jesus Christ and the blood of Christ flow through their veins, and they say, even the blood of Jesus is not enough to keep me saved. Hear me, when you read a chapter like this, it ought to make glory well up in your soul to think about that He will not lose one, but He will raise them up. It is the will of my Father. It is the will that I am His Son. It is the will that I'm going to believe in Him. He believes in me, and I'm going to raise up all those who believe in me who is sent by Him. The people begin to murmur. Now, this is what people do. You can feed people pie, and it won't be the right type of pie. I mean, they're people. How many of you have ever been dissatisfied for no good reason? Yeah, it gets the best of us. These people, He said, you're chosen, you'll come to me, you believe, I'll save you, I'll not lose any of you. I am the bread of life. I have proved this by these miracles that I have done. And here they go. They begin to murmur in disagreement. I am the bread of life that come down from heaven. They said, isn't this Jesus, the son of Joseph? Isn't this just a plain old man? He got skin like the rest of us. Isn't this guy thinks he's better than everybody? Isn't that this guy? We know his father. No, you don't. No, you don't. If you did, you wouldn't be saying this. We know his father. We know his mother. How can he say, I came down from heaven? Now, Jesus is replying to these things. And whether it's in their head or in their heart, did you know that Jesus can reply to you and what you've said even though nothing comes out of your mouth? It's beautiful. I love the passage where it says, and they thought, and then Jesus said, I know what you're thinking, and this is what I think about what you're thinking. Jesus knows our hearts. Jesus knows our thought processes and patterns, and he looks at them, and he says, stop complaining about what I said. For no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws them to me, and I will raise them up in the last day. For it is written, they will all be taught by God. Everyone who listens to the Father and learns from Him comes to me. Not that anyone has ever seen the Father, only I, who was sent from God, have seen Him. I tell you the truth. Anyone who believes has eternal life. Why do you come to Jesus? What's the point of coming to Jesus? Why do you want to remain in Jesus? Yes, I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate manna in the wilderness, but they all died. Moses is dead. Everyone's dead. All of your ancestors are dead. But anyone who eats this bread from heaven, go from the physical to the spiritual. Anyone who eats this bread will never die. I love that statement. For I once was dead in trespasses and sin, but my God has come down to heaven, robed in flesh. His name is Jesus, and He is that living bread that came down from heaven. Anyone who eats this bread will live forever. And this is the offer, hear me, which I offer so that the world may live. It is my flesh. Now, I said I would talk about remain, so here we go. The people begin to argue with each other. How can a man give us flesh to eat? Now, some people even mess this up. Some denominations think that when you take communion, it actually turns in. The bread turns into the body of Christ, literally turns into the body of Christ. And some say that the blood literally turns into the blood of Jesus Christ. That's not true. That's not true at all. That's a false doctrine. This is a spiritual matter played out in real time. Hear with your spiritual ears that your heart may receive this. How can a man give us his flesh to eat? I tell you the truth, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you cannot have eternal life within you. But anyone who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life. And I will raise this person at the last day. For my flesh is true food. Did you hear that? It's not about your belly. My flesh, Jesus said, is true food. And my blood is true drink. Can you imagine him saying this? Picture him right now saying these words. Anyone who eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me and I in him. Stays. It's not mere mental assent towards the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is the full-on giving of yourself and all that you are to everything that Christ is and wants you to do. Did you hear that? Oh, I got saved. Did you? We will see. Did you eat his flesh and drink his blood? Was it that serious to you? That you would lay down all that you have and all that you are to follow the one that came to the earth to make sure you didn't die and go to hell one day? That would literally sacrifice everything that he is so that you would sacrifice the rest of your life to please the one who came to this earth for you. It's so much more. Why do we have so many trivial issues in the church today? Because we hadn't taken serious the commands of eating flesh and drinking blood. You say, you can't be serious, preacher. Absolutely, I am serious. When people get serious about the things of God, the rest of this stuff goes by the wayside. We do our work. We serve our God. We live our lives to the glory of that King that we fully gave ourselves to in the moment that the Holy Spirit came with conviction and showed us the sinfulness of our lifestyles and that we were bound for hell at that moment. I don't care if you were 6 years old or 60 years old. If you didn't turn from your sin to follow him, you didn't get saved. But if you drank his blood and ate his flesh, then he remains in you. See, somebody thinks when I say, I'm going to teach you how to remain today. Well, he's going to tell us the things we need to do, the acts of righteousness that we need to do to stay in Christ. No, you don't understand. You got bad theology and doctrine. If I teach you how to be in Christ, the rest of that will come. If I can ever get everybody in Christ, I'll have to teach less behavioral reform. You listen to me? I have to teach less behavioral reform and more of Christ in me, the hope of glory. And that which he's put in me through the power of the Holy Spirit makes me who I am today. I am what I am. You will say this one day. I am what I am by the grace of God. And by his shed blood, he has empowered me and enabled me to walk the walk and talk the talk and be everything he's called me to be. Anyone who eats this flesh and drinks this blood, he is the one who remains. They went out from us. Hear me. People say you can lose your salvation. 1 John says that they went out from us because they never were a part of us. For if they'd ever been a part of us, they would have no doubt stayed with us. You listening to me? People don't leave God. They never find him. God doesn't leave people. He doesn't know them. And the people who remain are the ones that this verse 57, Christ understood, I live because of the living Father who sent me. In the same way, anyone who feeds on me will live because of him. You eat his flesh and drink his blood because it connects you, it reconciles you, it makes you right with the Father. I am the true bread that came down from heaven, and anyone who eats this bread will not die as your ancestors did, even though they ate manna, but they will live forever. I want you to do right, but I just want you to get it right so you can. I don't want you to just say, I'm going to be a better person. I want you to eat his flesh and drink his blood so that which is, Jesus said, my power that I have on this earth comes from the one I'm connected to. And now this morning, he's telling you the same thing. The power to remain is not found in, I'm going to do all this stuff. But the power for you to do what Christ has called you to do on this earth comes from your connection to him, because he's connected to the Father. See the trickle down? It's all a trickle down from the throne of God this morning. So what I encourage you is you to find out, which camp are you in? Which group are you in? Are you here for the miracles? Or are you here for the Messiah? It'll change your life. It'll change your eternity. And that's what Christ is after. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Which group are you in? In this moment, we, including myself, we search our souls. We search our souls. Have you come to the knowledge of Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Have you ate his flesh and drank his blood? Are you a child of God? Do you know you are? Have you? That's number one. It's always number one. Salvation comes to you today because of belief and stays away from you because of unbelief. Do you believe that Jesus is the one he proclaimed to be this morning? And would you put your faith in him? As this song says, I surrender. Would you surrender your life? Would today... Would you take the cup of suffering that he took? Would you drink from that cup this morning and create communion with God through faith in Jesus Christ? Would you take a drink of that blood of Christ this morning or chew on his flesh today? His flesh was torn off of him that he might robe you in righteousness. Would you eat and drink of Christ today? And then secondly, that's have you. Secondly is, are you? Now, I would say this would talk to the biggest crowd in here. There's already people coming to the altar. Our altar workers are over here to the left of the stage if you're looking at me to pray with you. So I would encourage you, if the Holy Spirit is pushing you or moving in your heart right now, to come to this altar and hear from God and give him all that you are. Come unto me, all that you that are burdened and heavy-hearted, and I will give you rest, whether it's salvation or whether it's other things going on in your life right now. Come, bend your knee and bow your head before a holy God. You come on as I continue to talk. It was, have you? Have you began that relationship in Christ? And then are you? Are you continually drinking and eating? Not in the fleshly sense, but in the spiritual sense. What I was convicted of this week is this. I understand I came into relationship one time. That day, I came into relationship with Jesus Christ, June the 8th of 2000. But I am called to fellowship with him every day, all the time. Is your thought processes and patterns more about your bank account, your hobbies, whatever, retirement? I don't know what you think about all the time. The next good thing, the next person, sex. I don't know what's got you that shouldn't have you. I don't know what that is in your life, but I understand what it is in mine. Are you saved, and are you continually, hear me, eating his flesh and drinking his blood? Are you continually in conversation, running towards the things of God? If there's anybody in this room right now that would say, I want to be closer to God, that's who I'm talking to right now. In this place right now, throwing yourself on this altar and saying, God, here I am. I know you. You know me. But God, I want to know more of you. And I am coming to you in this moment as I begin to pray. There's two different people coming to this altar, the saved and those who want to be. And let's get a hold of the throne of God. Father, in Jesus' name right now, as people begin to come to the altar, Father, I pray that we can do this business with you, Lord. This transactional time where you have spoken and we have listened. And Lord, that in this moment, Lord, the one that needs to be saved will be saved. And the saved, Lord, who are thinking of other things more than they're thinking of you, doing more things on some other level than they are,
trying to find out who you are and what you are and what you want and pressing into the things of God. I pray, Jesus, right now that the crowds would be separated. The sheep and the goats would know who they are, Father. The ones that want to see the miracles would understand why they want to do so, Father, and that we would all remain in you right now in Jesus' name. Every head bowed and every eye closed. People here praying. Don't waste this moment. Music's going to continue to play as these people continue to pray. We don't want to waste this time before the Lord. Who are you? What do you want? What drives you? Did you come to church today because you had to? Or did you come today because you want to? Why are you here? Does it matter who else comes to this church? It sure don't. Why are you here? You're here to promote you. You're here to promote him. Why are you here? Is this about the kingdom coming and his will being done? I am of the will of my Father who sent me. What's going on in your heart? Are you eating and drinking? Why are you eating and drinking? Work this out in yourself. Push yourself, oh God, that we might push ourselves past the point of being comfortable and knowing, Lord Jesus, that you have plans and they are perfect plans, Lord Jesus. To save all those that the Father gives you. And then those that the Father has given you to run towards you all of their days. I am thankful, God, for examples in Scripture of those who stayed in community. Who stayed in communion with you. And they ran the race and finished their course, God. And was laid up for them a great prize in heaven, Lord. We know our light affliction is but for a moment, but God, help us not get our eyes off of you and on temporal things, Lord. Help us be less worried about what's for lunch today and more worried about what's on the altar, what we need to leave and what we need to take back. And God, may our appetite for the things of this world be suppressed and our appetite for the things of God grow and grow and never be satisfied until we get to the place of glory. Lord, let your flesh and your blood be made real to us. And let us know that we know that we know that everything is right with the Maker of heaven and earth. And that we're walking in the direction you want us to work and walk. God, I love you. God, help me be more like you. God, I pray for myself at this very moment. Help me be more like you, God. Rid me of all things that are wrong. Get everything out of me, Father, that you don't want in me. Search the dark places in my soul and in my heart, Father. Do whatever you have to do in my life to make me more like you, Jesus. Whatever it takes, God. Whatever you want, God. Let this church be about your glory and nothing else. Your will and not our way. Bless us as we run towards you. Oh God, the path is hard and long, but it is worth it. And we thank you for setting such a good example, Jesus. Empower us and enable us in the days ahead to push back the things of the world and to bring in the things of Christ. Pour your Spirit out on all flesh today that will receive it and let your ways be made known in this room. God, bless my people in this place, God, the people you've given me to pastor, the flock that you've set before me, God. Bless them with an overabundant amount of your Spirit in their lives at this very moment, that, Lord, their thoughts and their ways would not be controlled by another spirit, but by the Spirit of the Holy God from heaven. Holy Spirit, have your way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Matt. All right, I've got just a couple of things I want to remind you about. Don't forget about our offering boxes that are on the back wall. If you could drop your offering in there. And then Sunday school at 9:30, so you have about 20 minutes to hang out, and we'll have Sunday school. If you got any questions about Sunday school, you can see Miss Janie Hunt or myself. We'll get you pointed in the right direction. And we do have baptism service today at 11 o'clock, so if you would like to be a part of that baptism service, you can come back after Sunday school, and we pack out the back of the church here, and we'll praise the Lord for those that are being baptized this morning. Let's all stand, and we'll be dismissed in a word of prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for the many blessings that you've given us, God. And we do ask that you would be with us during our time of Sunday school this morning. Pray that you would just help us to be bold this week as we go out into the workplace and we go to the store and we do different things, God, this week. I pray that you would help us to be a light in a dark place. Help us to show the love of Christ to everybody. We get a chance to show the love of Christ too. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Y'all are